I feel privileged today to be with you in this historic city of Kerala, Trivandrum, and to be part of you in this function, remembering a journalist, a veteran personality, Narendran, who has always spoken, written, and provided an orientation in the field of journalism towards the people of our state, people of our country, people in general. We have very few. Now the number is not so big as of today, as far as, please don't misunderstand me, the number is not so big as far as the journalist community is concerned, who spoke so loudly for the people, or who dare to make the system accountable. He was a crusader, as I was told, against corruption. And he could dare to speak the truth even in our times. So I feel proud of such veterans. We all of us feel like that, have the same feeling. And when I was told by my friend, we were not known to each other so closely. I was, despite a little reluctance because of the prevailing situation in Kashmir, but nevertheless, Kashmir, along with Kerala, Kerala is my another home, despite the barrier of language and all that, I was quick to respond and willing to participate in this function. You see, coming on the real topic which I have been assigned today, that is, which is now in the headlines, Kashmir crisis. I think picking up the threads of what Narendran stood for, telling the truth, I dare to say something which is maybe unpleasant for a few, for those who are in authority in the country as a whole, and finally very useful, very productive for the millions of our people working, living in different parts of our country. My friend was talking about Tarigami's commitment about the unity and integrity of the country. But besides, I want to add something more. That is, for us, for me as a citizen, this concept of unity and integrity of the country is not just geographical, not territorial, not at all. It may be important for kings, territorial empires. It may be important for those who have the huge vested interests. But for us, like many of us, I have this belief that when we talk of unity, it is the unity of our people. I am not looking at, and I invite you, my informed friends, you have something more to contribute, because we have this occasion of remembering a veteran, a daring personality, who did what others failed to do. Similarly, I invite you, I request you, you have to pick up threads, the factual threads regarding Kashmir, and so that my people in Kerala and elsewhere get educated, informed, and are not misled by stereotype theories and whatever is being said by the authorities. What actually Kashmir is, it gives me immense pain. It is a painful, painful story. And the pain is because the people in Kashmir have been subjected to such situations which are unfortunate not only for the people of Jammu and Kashmir, but for all those who see to this problem as a human tragedy. My dear friend, politics apart, I may have political views about many things, including the Kashmir situation, but certainly one part of it is, which is dominant in my view, it is a human problem, it is a tragedy, it is a big human tragedy which we must understand and which we must try to inform our people around. Kashmiris are bleeding. They are bleeding now. Kashmir is on fire. We cannot just imagine what is happening in Kashmir. And the only theory from the governments, from those who are at the helm of affairs, is either they project it as a Pakistani problem, something Pakistan is creating, or something like terrorist creation. That's not enough. That's not the real story. That's not the whole story. The real story is that this is the story of betrayals, story of denial of very elementary rights to our people. This is unfortunate narration of what the authorities have done so far towards our people. I dare to speak here from this land of Comrade E.M.S. Namoodiri Pad. I have been working under his guidance in the Central Committee of CPIM for some time. And I have seen I remember just one incident when 1984, elected government was ousted by creating splits, defections by the then government of India through Governor of Jammu and Kashmir. E.M.S. Namoodiri Pad led a delegation of oppositional parties just to express solidarity with the people of Kashmir. I just remember his words when he left us, when we just were with him during curfew time. He said that I have just come to Kashmir to register my protest against whatever is being done with the people of Kashmir. And besides, I am here to stand in solidarity with the suffering people of Kashmir. These were the two words. I was with him. Not only that, I just want to remind, we have certain similarities, Kerala and Kashmir. It was in Kashmir where the first, after independence, first non-Congress government under the leadership of Sheikh Abdullah was there, and it was another government in Kerala, not first. The second government in Kerala under the leadership of EMS, non-Congress government, which came into being in Kerala. This is the similarity. You see, what was the fate? The fate of it was the first government, popular government, the government instrumental in cementing the relationship between state of Jammu and Kashmir and Indian Union. The leadership of Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah, he was dismissed in 1953 and imprisoned. Again, what happened in Kerala after a few years, the first mandate of the people here in Kerala was shamelessly disowned, disrespected, and that government was dismissed. My point is not today to score the points, political points. I am not here for that purpose. My point is, whenever the democratic processes are laid down by the Constitution are not accepted, are not respected, or are either disrupted, the net result is certain amount of disruption, which leads to many things. In context of Kashmir, it has led to the present situation. Very unfortunate situation. Before I come to the real part of the whole story, I just want to remind this August gathering, my friends here, learned friends, that look what happened. You see, it is not the question of just one incident taking place today. It's not the eruption only of today. Kashmir has been facing uninterruptedly different phases of eruption. Maybe sometimes peaceful, maybe not, non-peaceful channels. But Kashmir has not been in peace with itself. Not that Kashmiris do not like it, do not want to be peaceful. They are the people like all of us. They want a good life. They don't want to get their children killed. They don't want their life to be disrupted time and again. They don't want that Kashmir should be turned into a big graveyard for their dear ones. This is all because of certain situations which have emerged. I just want to remind you, because there are many, many, many stories are being floated. There is a huge campaign going on against whatever in Kashmir is, whatever Kashmir is. Those facts are being distorted and Kashmir is being projected in a very different manner. I just want to put the record straight. Kashmir uncertainty is not today. It has been right from the day of partition of the country. And look, understand this. At that point of time, when there was a choice with the people of Jammu and Kashmir, with every state, to join either Indian domain or Pakistani, there was a choice with them. And here was a piece of, there is a small area called Jammu and Kashmir, bordering with Pakistan, and then essentially Muslim majority area. Muslim League wanted them to be part of them on the basis of the two nation theory. They tried. They did not succeed. Not because there was anything else. It was not Indian army which enabled the accession. It was not any type of a force. It was essentially the will of the people of Jammu and Kashmir which was responsible for this union of the state with this country. Just to remind you, it was Maharaja Hari Singh who was reluctant for quite some time. He was reluctant to join Indian Union. Go through the pages of history. I just want to tell those who are now talking about patriotism and nationalism and all that, just remembering them, reminding them about the real story of Kashmir. At the time of partition, Maharaja Hari Singh and the then Hindu leadership at that point of time, nowadays they are the same face as of BJP. They were not willing to join Indian Union. That's why it took time. And there was a standstill agreement offered to India, to Pakistan. And finally, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru said, unless Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah, unless there is a people's sanction, people's support for any political move of relationship, we cannot accept. Sheikh Abdullah was under detention. And during that very period, raiders came from Pakistan. An abnormal situation was created. It was under those circumstances that Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah, the then popular leader, the leader of the people there, who was essentially instrumental in making this relationship possible. And what were the conditions? Again, just one historical fact. The fact is then all other states merged with Indian Union because of the uniqueness, because of the peculiar conditions prevailing in Jammu and Kashmir. It was the only state which acceded to Indian Union with certain promises, with certain conditions. And that is why, in the Constituent Assembly of India, after thorough debate and discussion, a clause was incorporated in the Constitution called Article 370, which defines the relationship of union with Kashmir, which put a certain frame of relationship between the Jammu and Kashmir state and Indian Union. It is under those unique situations that in the only state of Jammu and Kashmir, one more constituent assembly was constituted. Please try to understand, in the rest of the country, for the whole of the country, there was one constituent assembly, and there was one more constituent assembly in Jammu and Kashmir as well, to frame their own constitution, apart from the constitution of the whole country. This is a unique historical situation in which this relationship came into being. Then what happened later on? Pakistan never accepted this relationship. Pakistan, most of the time, did not honorably work towards this relationship. They tried several times, so that this relationship does not sustain.
But that is part of their game plan. What did our leadership do to strengthen this relationship between the Union and Jammu and Kashmir? How did they promote it? The same personality, the same instrument. Who was the backbone of this relationship called Sheikh Abdullah? He was arrested soon after. After 47, a few years after 9th August 1953, he was arrested. He was put in jail for so many years. Please try to understand it. Did it help the larger interest of the country? Did it help to strengthen the unity of Jammu and Kashmir with the rest of the country? The whole record of events since then, they confirm that this has proved suicidal. There are different interpretations. Some people say that Sheikh Abdullah afterwards, he was thinking of having independent Kashmir. But my question is, the same Sheikh Abdullah and his colleagues who rejected two-nation theory of Mr. Jinnah, who opted for a relationship with Indian Union, what were the compelling situations which enabled or which created some sort of an environment forcing Sheikh Abdullah to give up that commitment? These are historical blunders committed by our leaders. Historical blunders. Then again, one thing I must remind you, after so many of detention, so many years of detention of Sheikh Abdullah and his colleagues, it is in 1964, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru releasing him and then assigning him this job, requesting him to visit Pakistan to have a political settlement of this disputed issue. Sheikh Abdullah visits Pakistan on the advice of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. Unfortunately, before he returns back, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru passes away. Again, this is the history, part of the history. And that was a very, very unfortunate setback to the process of reassessment of the situation, process of resettling the issues through dialogue with Pakistan and with the leadership of Jammu and Kashmir. But my point here is, please look to the larger issues. These are the areas which have been grossly mishandled. The net result is, this is the legacy of many, many wrongs which we are inheriting today. Then again, in 74, there is again agreement of, after so many decades, after so many turmoils, after so many unfortunate developments, Sheikh Abdullah Indira Accord takes place after the dismemberment of Pakistan and emergence of Bangladesh. Please look what has happened to that accord. Even that, where the certain assurances were given. That was not an adequate response to the emerging situation of Kashmir. That was not a sufficient response to the uncertainties of Kashmir. But nevertheless, in a limited manner, whatever was underlined by two leaders, Indira Gandhi and Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah, please look into it, whether even those limited promises were taken forward. Not at all. You see, what followed afterwards, it's not one story. This is first broken promises, not respecting the mandate of the people, not respecting the constitutional guarantees of provided by our Constituent Assembly towards the people of Jammu and Kashmir, not promoting that frame of relationship which emerged out of a certain historical necessities. It was, the question was again treated in a partisan manner. It was never taken as a national question. The other part of it is, which followed, that is erosion of whatever federal structure was existing in Jammu and Kashmir, whatever so-called superficial frame of certain governance was created here in Jammu and Kashmir, a gross erosion of that process. I just want to remind you, it was not, the first thing is, Kashmiris wanted more powers, a special status in terms of governance, in terms of development. Of course, as a student of politics, I do feel that there has to be, that is the key link of the whole unity of India. We have to give more powers to states elsewhere, everywhere. What happened there? It is the only state where not only that special position has been eroded, but certain other unwarranted clauses of constitution have been imposed, which have virtually led to disempowerment of the state itself. It is unequal now. Earlier it was that it is enjoying more powers with the rest of the country, but now it is having less powers. Article 249, that was imposed in 1986, which necessitated, which facilitated that the union can, parliament can enact any state law with a resolution of Rajya Sabha. Anywhere, it's not possible as far as Kerala is concerned, it's not possible elsewhere. But it is possible vis-a-vis Jammu Kashmir only. You please try to understand how much painful it has been, how much treacherous it has been, how much subversion has taken place to undermine the very basic principles of our unity. Now, the question of democracy as the rest of the country is enjoying what happened in Kashmir. Governors, through governors, every time, most of the time, not election, but imposition of puppet governments on Jammu and Kashmir. Puppet governments. We have a history of virtually even oath forms, even nomination papers were rejected on flimsy grounds. This is unfortunate, the ugliest face of intrigues. Virtually there has been attempt time and again, desperation rather, to make Jammu and Kashmir constitutionally in the name of getting it integrated through mechanical way, not making Jammu and Kashmir part of Indian democracy. There was no attempt to make it part and parcel of Indian democracy. Somehow the notion has been, they are alien people, they have to be kept with, they have to be made to be part of India, whether they like it or not. It's not one regime, it's not only today when we have a very, very, some frame of politics which is highly, highly communal in nature, divisive in nature. It is even in those days when we were having a very secular leadership in the country. Now what happened then? Kashmiris were branded as they are cowards, they are docile because of accumulated anger, because of accumulated deprivation, dissatisfaction, emergence of a big insurgency, massive alienation. Right from 90 till today, it is a history of violence, different waves of violence. It is a history of terror and counter-terror. What has been the solution provided by the successive governments again? How the successive governments have responded to emerging situation? Not by analyzing the ground realities, not by accepting the wrongs committed, not by identifying the areas to be attended to, but the only thing is, might of Indian state, send more and more troops. Now what are the facts today? It is around 7 lakh of security forces. The number is 7 lakh. Nowhere in the world, proportionate to the size of the population, nowhere. Does it suit the interests of the country? Does it suit? Does it suit all of us domestically? Does it suit all of us, the prestige of the country, in the community of the people around the whole globe? Does it behave a civilized nation? Here lies a big question. On the one hand, we have been told that the militancy has come down, it is now numbering maybe 1,000, maybe 1,000, 2,000 around. And on the other hand, we are only supplementing the already overburdened security apparatus. Do you know recently what happened? When Prime Minister was abroad, when this eruption took place, massive, he said, I am concerned and all that. One word he said. And then the other news item was, more troops have been sent to Delhi. It is shocking for a person like me. How does this great country behave? Why don't they draw lessons? Why don't they understand the situation? They are reluctant. And the people of India, people of the country are paying the price. We have been, CPIM and other forces, we have been struggling, we have been doing whatever little is possible. Many of us, mainstream parties, they have suffered. Their workers got killed, many innocents. It's a tragedy, as I was telling you. And with this hope that someday, those who matter in the situation will draw some lesson and initiate certain processes which can help in promoting, building this broken relationship again. But we are saddened. I'm so disillusioned now. And don't feel, you see, we have been time and again, when one phase of eruption is a little over, some sort of a peace is seen. Do you know what we talk of in Delhi and elsewhere, in the corridors of power, as if fatah ho gaya, we have conquered some territory. They are exchanging glasses and all that. Not drawing lessons, no. Not understanding the pain of the people. And that is why, right from the day first, right from 53, there has never ever been a serious political initiative which could have helped the country and helped the people of Jammu and Kashmir to overcome this crisis. Not even now. You see, this mass protest, this was seen in 2008 in a big way. Now, we have been living together, Jammu and Kashmir. We were sharing many, many unpleasant things together. What happened in 2008, there were certain gaps as well. Those gaps were to be breached, but unfortunately, political engineers have engineered something which divided our hearts too, which virtually developed that gap between one community and another. That is a routine exercise of the rulers. Everywhere, if they cannot deliver, the only instrument with which they can beat the people is divide them on the basis of religion, divide them on the basis of region, caste, or whatever. That is what our masters have taught them, the Britishers. Now again, it's being projected. The Kashmir situation is projected as a simple Muslim problem. I don't deny that the Muslim population there. I don't deny that there will be certain element of that color as well. But it is beyond that. It is much more than that. It's not a communal problem in my view. I just want to bring it to your notice this evening that in 1947 during partition, when this western borders got virtually were bleeding with communal rights in Punjab area, not only in Punjab area, but in Jammu and Kashmir as well, Jammu area, lot of bloodshed took place. It was Kashmir Valley where not even a single communal incident took place. That's why Mahatma Gandhi said, here lies the ray of hope. What has happened to that ray of hope? Who destroyed that hope? How the whole face of Kashmir is changed today? Who has brutalized the society? That tolerant society, which once was virtually a guiding factor for nation building in the whole country. My friends, such situations of disappointment, such situations of disillusionment lead us to a situation of hopelessness, and hopelessness finally leads to desperation, and desperation means open ground for extremism. That's quite natural. I am even again worried today, much more, whatever we are facing today, it is not one phase, another round of eruption. It is much more than that. Now today again the same younger generation in thousands, they dare to face the bullet. They dare to attack Thana, police station. They dare to attack. It's not a terrorist, it's not a militant going with a gun. No, the common man in thousands. Thousands marching towards army camp, telling them, kill us all. Why this situation has erupted in such a manner? Why these hardened positions now? Who is responsible? I was telling you that government of India, successive governments, they did many wrongs, but no government was there seen to be drawing lessons and doing something which can at least initiate some process which can create confidence among the people. Since this government has taken place, Mr. Modi's government, earlier we were having, when during this turmoil, Narasimha Rao was there, when there was peak of militancy, peak of terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir, he said, we can provide anything about autonomy. Sikha is the limit. Sikha is the limit. And when NDA government came under Atal Bihari Vajpayee, he came to Srinagar, he said, when he was posed the question that separatists will not talk to you under the ambit of Constitution of India, he said, it's not the question of talking within the ambit of Constitution of India, we will not force them. We provide them a broader forum, that is insaniyat, humanity. We can talk within the ambit of humaniyat, insaniyat, humanity. Did it anything mean for the people of Kashmir? Was there any initiative? Atal Bihari Vajpayee was in Kerala in those days. There was a piece of article, I don't remember now in which paper, he said, now we have to, as far as Kashmir is concerned, we have to give up the beaten tracks. That is a very, very known quote from Atalji. Beaten tracks have to be given up. We have to reach to the people by evolving some process of which is out of box. We have to come out of the rigidities. But what happened then? Now Mr. Modi is there now. During this turmoil, more than 50 young men got killed. Dozens got blinded with pellet guns. Blinded. Thousands got injured, not hundreds, thousands. And our Prime Minister does not have even a second to speak about this pain. He doesn't speak, he speaks everything, Man Ki Baat on radio. He speaks with Obama, he speaks with everywhere, but he does not speak to our Aman people. He does not share the grief and sorrow which our own people are facing. Will it help us? Is this the way which our country can afford to offer to the injured psyche of Kashmir? Will it help us winning over the broken minds of the people of Kashmir? Even now, we met, CPIM delegation met Rajnath Singh Home Minister, and we requested that you should visit Kashmir. He visited there, met some people there, and then after his conclusion at the airport, addressed a press conference and said, we pleaded that these pellet guns have created havoc here. Virtually, many people, our hospitals are full of eye injury patients. And we pleaded for, please put a stop. And he announced that pellet guns will not be used here. In the parliament, this issue was taken up by the opposition. And he was replying that within two months' time, the committee will set up, will report back what actually is to be done with the use of this pellet gun and all that. But I posed the question in Srinagar, Mr. Home Minister, 2 months are enough to make us all blind here. Please put a stop. He announced, but do you know what happens? You are journalists, please ask your friends in Srinagar who are part of this community. It has not been stopped. It is brazenly being this use of pellet guns that goes on. Even the DGCRPF said that we can't afford to give it up, as if we can't just control the situation without making the people blind. See, how serious is the situation? How painful is the situation? What we are asking for, there has to be a credible initiative by the government of India to reach to the people of Jammu and Kashmir. We are just asking them to talk to all the shades of opinion, all the stakeholders, including those who are not part of the democratic process. You have talked to Nagas. Naga rebels you have talked to. And you have earlier talked to Hizbul Mujahideen during NDA first. When at that point of time, Deputy Prime Minister was asked, they are militants and you are talking to them. Your government is having dialogue with them. The answer was, we are talking to our own boys. They were your boys then. Whose boys are they now? BJP has to explain it to the country. They must explain. And now, unfortunately, in 2010, when around 120 boys got killed, we persuaded the government of India and all opposition forces, in fact CPIM and plus some other friends in other political parties, we worked together and we persuaded them to visit, have an all-party delegation there. There was a delegation led by Chidambaram, the then Home Minister. And we again, some of us together, persuaded that delegation to visit separatist leaders as well. There was some reluctance. Even BJP was part of that delegation, today's Finance Minister, and today's Foreign Minister was part of that delegation. But finally they decided. They visited Mr. Gilani, they visited Mr. Bhirwais, they visited Mr. Yasin Malik, important three leaders of separatist camp. You did not object at that time. You were part of the same delegation. When we are suggesting that please convene an all-party meeting, this is a national question. It is nation in crisis as far as Jammu and Kashmir is concerned. It is a crisis situation in one part of the country, which needs to be addressed by the whole nation. Convene the meeting of all political parties. There is no response. Send an all-party delegation to all-party delegation, parliamentarians, to visit Srinagar and to meet different people, different shares of opinion. There is no response. We are asking them to talk to Pakistan. And you know, this is the regime which once campaigned against, whenever Congress was making any noise to talk to Pakistan, they were campaigning against that. Now, all of a sudden, there was a change of heart. And even Narendra Modi surprising the whole South Asia, from Kabul to Pindi, a big surprise. No, Modi style. Visiting Lahore, attending the wedding ceremony of the Prime Minister's daughter. You are trying to make relationships. But when we talk of Kashmir is burning, there is some problem, please talk to them. You are saying Pakistan is an enemy? Pakistan is a friend when you are jumping into without any notice to anybody? Now, there is a big terrorist attack taking place in Pathankot. That's not unusual terms. Extraordinary attack. A military base is being attacked. And since NSAs, even then NSAs are talking together, National Security Advisor, not bad, very good, we encourage. You have to talk. And then you are even allowing the team of Pakistani officers, including ISI, to visit your military establishments. We again say, of course, maybe your wisdom. But when we are asking you to talk to them, you have different channels. Have a serious dialogue with Pakistan and sort over the issues. There are many issues between the two countries. There is, and among them, one important issue is, which is long pending, that is, the competitive claims of both the countries over Kashmir. Talk about this issue as well. This hampers the progress. Pakistan is what it is. They have enough money to spend on armament race, to buy weaponry. Equally, we are here hard pressed as far as developmental issues are concerned, unemployment issues are concerned, but we are forced to spend a lot of money on armaments, on different weaponry, just at the cost of the living livelihood of the common Indian. Please put a stop. Talk together. Here in Pakistan, there are voices emerging too. There are certain constituencies which are not quite happy with whatever is going on in Pakistan. And certainly in our country, there is a huge constituency. They want peace around. They want issues to be settled. And that's why I appeal to them today that here is an long-pending historical issue, a long-pending humanitarian issue, a human tragedy which cries for its solution. Please help us. I am still hopeful that there can be way forward. There is possibilities of, despite all odds, that the present crisis can be overcome, provided pressure is built up on the authorities to realize the gravity of the situation and initiate a process of first accepting the realities on the ground, recognizing the uncertainties, the nature of those uncertainties, and evolving some process of credible dialogue with all political stakeholders in the state. I am sure that some beginning can be made. I am sure, if at all, the governments are serious, the government of India is serious, they take into confidence the other opinions in the country as a whole, they try to develop a consensus, they try to develop some sort of a mechanism which can enable us to reach even those sections of the society which are alienated. I feel convinced that still there is a hope, it's not a lost case. But I have a serious hunch. I have a serious concern about if at all it is delayed, if it is not attended to, if lessons are not drawn, it will lead us to more trouble in future. Look, whatever is happening in the world, I just remember there was a small area, a tiny area on the border of Afghanistan and Pakistan called Taliban or whatever you call it. It was not a big issue, it was not a big problem in size. Now, when Americans stepped in, and the response was massive, massive bombardments and massive violence unleashed against the population, you have seen the results. The same Afghan people have been peace-loving. Now it has become a hell on earth. Another area. You look what has happened to where Saddam Hussein was once, at least, one may not be an admirer of Saddam Hussein, but certainly those days were better, what we are seeing today. Iraq has not only become a hell for the people of Iraq, but virtually it has initiated certain amount of such ferocious forces which are devastating the whole area around Iraq. Who is responsible for this situation? Now, whatever is happening in Syria, whatever is happening in Libya, have a look around. I'm not just frightening anybody here. I just wish to understand the gravity of the situation around. This may not be the situation good for us. This may not be good for the whole region, including Pakistan, India. That's why Pakistan must realize, our country must realize, and the political leadership must understand the gravity in the situation and try to not to allow those forces to take advantage of such unfortunate situation. That's why the prevention is not relying on security forces exclusively. The solution lies opening up channels of communication. Options lie in certain amount of opening up certain avenues which can create some sort of a confidence. Opening up some opportunities where our younger generation can see hope for their future. Providing some clue for so that they can understand the difficulties, they can understand the gravity, they can understand the devastation. And help them to shape their future in a better way. We have to help them. We should not, we cannot push the younger generation anywhere, particularly in sensitive areas like Kashmir, towards the wall. Don't do that. This human being has to be given some dignity, some dignity. He has not to be just isolated. He has not to be just made desperate. Some sort of an initiative is required. That's why I request you, the journalist community, when we remember the great personality today, we have to come to terms with the growing realities. We have to understand the pain of Kashmiri people. We have to send a message to the people of Kashmir that you are not alone. We share your grief. If the governments fail, let the civil society pick up the threads. Let our intelligentsia come forward. It cannot be the monopoly of only a section of rulers who are blind enough not to accept certain amount of environments which is not conducive for the growth of the country. We have to pick up the threads and urge upon the authorities, and we have to pick up the threads to send a message of hope, to send a message of some sort of a belonging to those people who feel wounded today. That's my earnest appeal to the people of Kerala, a place which is diverse, like ours, full of diversities, which is full of a history of struggles, which can understand the difficulties with which our people in Kashmir are undergoing. And we hope your positive message, your message of concern, your message of solidarity will at least send them some sort of a hope for future. Thank you very much. You have given me this opportunity and you have listened to me in this evening, and hopefully that we together can make it. Thank you very much.
I have around 6 to 7 friends in Kashmir. 5 logon se meri baat ab tak nahi hui hai. Unka ghar hai Gandarbal mein. 20 din pehle maine pucha tha. They said they have rice, provisions, vegetables and milk. 10 din pehle maine phone kiya. They are sharing milk. There is no vegetables. There is no meat. And few days ago I called. There is no TV. They are not able to recharge. They have only rice. Jagah jagah pe langar liye ja rahe hain. That means there is community. They get together, they cook something and eat, they share. Hazratbal mein namaz nahi padi gayi pichle ek mahine se. I could feel all those, and that is why I was hearing each and every alphabet of what you were uttering. Bahut gussa. I didn't feel any kind of hamdardi or compassion. What I was feeling is this extreme gussa. You said na, desperation. I was feeling from within, because Kashmiris, let me admit to this house, Kashmiris offer the best hospitality in the entire world. I had stayed for 7 days. Koi nahi keh sakta ki wahan pe problem hai. They offer the best hospitalities. They are wonderful people there. Why is not the left front able to create a pressure so that it facilitates a dialogue between the separatists and the union government?
You try to understand that it's not the question of left being not big in number, in size, as a whole. I'm not talking of Kerala. You are a great force. Left is a big force here. But in most of the areas of the country, we are not very big to put pressure which is required. And that's why my opinion is, it is not only the left, but all other like-minded people who feel concerned about the situation. That is the democratic forces, civil society, the intelligentsia, mass organizations, and other secular segments of our society. They must pick up the threads and speak for the people of Kashmir and against whatever is being done, which is not required to be done. And that's why today we have sent notices to the concern for debate, one more round of debate tomorrow in the parliament. And maybe if the government does not send the delegation to Srinagar, we in the opposition, and we are taking the lead, the left is taking the lead, we will be visiting Kashmir Valley. But you see, that is putting pressure on those who can take decisions. It's not the question of only solidarity, which is of course very important, but finally it is the question of making government to listen to the ground. And people of Kashmir are conveying something, and nobody is hearing, nobody means in authority. So finally, let us see, it is finally, in my view, the public opinion in different areas, in different areas of public influence, which is important to make the government understand first and then act accordingly. CPIM and the left forces, of course, they are playing their role, and I'm sure they will not be behind in this very important juncture of our history. And I'm happy. You may not agree with me, I may not agree with you, nevertheless, we are talking together. And that will help us in bridging the gaps, coming nearer, understanding each other's concerns. That's exactly what I want. The country must open up the channels of communication with everybody wherever certain such problems exist or emerge. Number one. Number two, you have said that, you have just questioned my assertion that in 47, not a communal incident, single communal incident took place in Srinagar. You are accepting that is a fact. And then you are saying that that was a Sufi Islam, now it is a Punjabi Islam and all that. My point is simply, no more discussion. We can have a discussion, longer discussions, whenever you provide such opportunity. You visit Srinagar, I visit here, we can talk about this issue. My only question is, this is a big change, isn't it? A situation in 47, not even a single communal incident takes place. While as in adjoining area of Jammu, thousands getting affected in communal clashes. In Punjab, bordering our Punjab and their Punjab, virtually lot of bloodshed. Hindus get killed, Sikhs get killed, Muslims get killed. But nearby area, Kashmir Valley, not even a single communal incident takes place. Both of us agree. That's why I'm saying why this change has taken place. The same people who were so harmonious, who were so proud of their traditions of brotherhood, have undergone changes, such big change, which looks something different from what existed in 1947. This cannot be just simplified just because Pakistan wanted it. They wanted in 47 to annex it, grab it, by sending tribal invaders. And it was Kashmiri Muslim who stood up, said that religion cannot be the basis of nationhood. And there are evidences when in Baramullah they reached there, Kashmiri volunteers said, हम कश्मीरी हैं तैयार, ये जो रेडर्स हैं, तुम खबरदार रहो, हम कश्मीरी हैं तैयार. This was the slogan. Now, why this situation has undergone such a big change? That's my question to every Indian. Who is responsible for this? By just simplifying it that Pakistan is doing it, Pakistan did it then, Pakistan will continue to do it. What my country's leadership has done to strengthen that personality of tolerance, that personality of promoting harmony in the relationships, that Kashmir, which has been plural, that ethos, which has been rich in communal harmony. Where is that Kashmir? Who destroyed my Kashmir? The dream of my Kashmir? That's my question to the whole of the country. Not to you as a citizen, because you are not responsible, but to those who have been in power in Delhi, shaping, making whatever they wanted in Kashmir and elsewhere. That's number one. Number two, you said similarity. I said that there are certain similarity. Now there is a similarity that in Kerala, it's a huge, it's a beautiful area, isn't it? And Kashmir too is. You cannot say no, Kashmir has become ugly. It continues to be an attraction. This is the similarity. I said that there is a similarity that there was one non-Congress government here, Sheikh Abdullah. I said another way is, in Kerala, first time in the rest of the country, EMS government, non-Congress government was there. Again, a factual thing I have narrated here. This is the similarity. Again, another part of the history is that government was dismissed. And this government was dismissed. This is another similarity. Have I said anything else, sir? I have not said that we are bad and you two are bad. I have not said that. We are bleeding. I don't wish that anybody else should bleed. I have not said it. We are undergoing tremendous pain. I have not said that my very dear brethren in the rest of the country should have the such a pain. I have not said it. What I have said it. Please understand our pain. Please just try to share our grief. That is what I have suggested here. And besides, people are always good everywhere, sir. I have visited many areas in my lifetime. As far as this militancy and all that, my friend has said, I have lost my comrades, I have lost my relatives, close relatives, how much attack and all that. That's not the, you see, it's not anything I'm favoring the country. It is my conscience, it is my commitment to certain values that I am not accepting anything which I feel bad for the people, for myself, for the whole of the country. I am discharging my duty, but I have more duty. I am rather reminding myself about the responsibility which I should share along with the rest of my countrymen, that is, ask those in power to make corrections wherever we have gone wrong. I think that is helping the country in moving forward. That is helping the country to come out of the crisis which all of us are facing in Kashmir. Thank you.
Comrade, it's a really a privilege to listen to you. And I could sense the anguish in your mind, which we completely share. We certainly have a sense of oneness with you in this. And we are grateful to you to come here and tell us about this as you see it on the ground. If I may take the liberty of pointing out one aspect that you left out. Your cautious optimism, to my judgment, is not warranted. I'm being very frank about it. I'm from the Indian Foreign Service. I dealt with Pakistan for 14 years in the ministry and in mission in Islamabad and so on. Kashmir was throughout my charge. One thing I have noticed all along is this, that you heard a point of view now from someone who worked in the armed forces. Strong vested interests have developed.
Huge vested interests have developed.
Now, the most frightening part of the situation in Kashmir is not that sagacity is lacking on the part of the Indian political leadership, but that big vested interests have formed. And there is also a nexus between the establishment in Delhi, the armed forces and so on and so forth, plus certain sections of the political class,
yes,
in Jammu and Kashmir. Now, I cannot see how this nexus can be broken ever, because there is very big money involved in this. There is a big gravy train running. You see the lifestyle of the armed forces there. You see, you know, and you, we are all as common citizens, we are on the defensive if you even mention this. Now, to my judgment, a very simple solution should have been abrogating the Armed Forces Powers Act, if it had been done. Now in Tripura, the chief minister, it is a CPM government. When they proposed this, everyone said, no, 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 the whole place will go up in flames. But the CPM government insisted on removal of that. It was removed, nothing happened. So similarly, that is the kind of thing that we should work on. And you know, unfortunately, the previous government, I think it succumbed to the pressure from the defense ministry. The defense minister himself was weak-kneed, couldn't take a stand on
it. And he happens to be from this.
He happens to be from Kerala.
Yes, to be Kerala.
Kerala. And so I'm mentioning this in particular because I am actually taking a bipartisan approach. I'm not talking against Hindutva or Narendra Modi or anything. It's even under the successive governments
and, have failed. Which we should talk.
Yes, sorry?
Which we should, yeah. Otherwise.
Yeah, but successive governments have failed. And one main reason is this. So given this strong corpus of vested interests operating in the valley, do you have any reason to hope for, even if you build a political opinion in the country?
You see, the question is the vested interests and all that. Again, if you look into the whole genesis of the emergence of the vested interests, there, here and everywhere, it's all because of the political system which we have. You see, it is not in vacuum that some vested interest is emerging. As you rightly put it, because of the part of the political leadership being reluctant not to do whatever is to be done, required to be done in Kashmir, like removal of EFSA. So that is again itself a vested interest. But having said that, if there is a powerful public opinion in the rest of the country about all these issues, that's why we see an alternative to the huge vested interest. Leave aside Kashmir. Otherwise also, the vested interest of corporate sector, the vested interest of bureaucracy, the vested interest of many layers of the power can be demolished once we have an informed people around. Once there is a mood to change it, and people can change it. People have already in history made certain attempts and succeeded as well. There are failures, but there are successes as well. You see, as far as Kashmir is concerned, why I'm talking about political is because the whole vested interest has emerged out of politically not doing what is required to be done. I'm not saying anything, I'm not demanding anything to do, what is not possible to do, what is not required to be done. But my point is that all of us, if you go through the pages of the history, right from 47 till now, right from great leaders like Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru and many others, they have made commitments to the people of Kashmir. And my friend from his defense forces, full of patriotism and full of the emotions regarding many things. But I must remind him just one thing, that we have to be concerned about the people as well. People are never bad. People are not bad anywhere. They are being made bad by political systems, by systems which are responsible for governing the society. And I'm hopeful. That's why they are taking advantage of ignorance of the people. That's why there are whole myths around being spread, as if it is the question of creation of Pakistan. Pakistan has been always there. That is the question of just militants. Now, I'm telling you, militants, how many militants you have in Kashmir? Ask the government. Tell them in the parliament to state the position of the militancy as of now, number of them. Whether EFSA is required, for what? How much army for internal security is required? Army is required for borders, yes. I do accept this requirement. But whether army is required for internal security of such a size where the number of the militants is not that much. When you are army for internal security, when you have huge security apparatus in Kashmir, unequal to the size of militants, what for this apparatus is to control the people, Should the people be controlled with the barrel of the gun? Is it acceptable in today's times, elsewhere, anywhere? A big question must be debated over. Peace normalcy, whenever that has been there, that has been quite deceptive. You see, even this present day turmoil will get calmed down. It will get down. It will be managed by the big governments there, here. But that does not mean you have restored normalcy. Normalcy with danda, with force, that's no normalcy. That's what I'm saying. That this is a festering wound. Not today, right from the day first. Please diagnose it properly. Please just offer a treatment to this huge problem. And in my opinion, the ailment is because of political bunglings by the governments, both in Srinagar as well as in Delhi. Ill treatment towards the people of Kashmir, which has compounded the crisis. And it is today's unrest is the reflection of the intense feelings of that compounded alienation. Please try to understand it. That's what I am suggesting. What it was in 2010, it was horrible. What is today? It is much bigger, much full of intensity, much worse than what we had seen in 2008, 2010, and even 90, some people are saying. It will be much more assertive, much more destructive in future if it is not responded through political process. That's my suggestion. 2014, we participated in election of the same boys who are up with anger, fighting the security forces and police and all that, everybody. They were part of the political process. What went wrong? PDP, Kashmiri Party, they complained about other issues that once we are in power, we will restore the dignity lost, we will provide you all those things which have been denied to you. Good. Again, they said that there is a big challenge emerging, that is in the form of emergence of BJP. We have to resist its march. Only PDP can resist it. Vote for us. They voted. And in Jammu region, BJP said that till now it was Kashmir which was ruling us. Earlier we were having Dogra rule. Kashmir is snatched. Now we will restore that pride of Dogras. We will put an end to Kashmiri rule. Now we will be having a Hindu chief minister. We will be having, now the time has come when Shyama Prasad Mukherjee martyred, got himself martyred in Srinagar jail. He fought for total integration with Indian Union, abrogation of Article 370. Now is the time. We have a government in Delhi. We must have a government in Jammu and Kashmir. We will do whatever was not being done in the past. People of Jammu voted. So total polarization in Jammu, BJP emerging, and in PDP, in Kashmir, PDP promising to stop the onslaught of BJP, getting maximum support. After elections, both the parties coming together to share the power, do you feel the people are fools? They will not get disillusioned. They will accept your everything bad you are doing, not you. I mean politicians. So this is partly, this is partly of the result of that disillusionment. Now, what is happening in the rest of the country, I just want to remind. Don't you think that Kashmiris have not joined the Muslim Pakistan? Bordering with Pakistan, Kashmir, a Muslim majority area. rejecting two-nation theory and joining what? Secular India. Now when somebody is talking, I am a Hindu, I am a nationalist, so I am a Hindu nationalist. So somebody in Kashmir feels threatened. He says that I am a Muslim, I am a nationalist, I am a Muslim nationalist. So Muslim nationalist and Hindu nationalist cannot remain together. They want freedom then. You understand? Please try to understand. Who is creating such situation? Now who will eat what? Who will eat what? Lot of people in my country are starving. They are not getting anything to eat. Lot of people, many of our countrymen in remote areas are not getting adequate food. Now you are debating whether we should eat this thing or that thing, this variety of meat or that variety of meat in the country. Is this the priority for the country? And is this the priority of the country sending police to inspect the kitchen of Kerala house in Delhi? What Keralaites will eat and what they will not eat? Don't you feel insulted about this attitude? What will happen to Kashmir? Somebody, a clerk in UP, is getting lynched just because of suspicion? Do you feel that it will not send shock waves to the minorities? You tell me, my dear friend, when the question of 370 is already eroded, you are approaching courts, you are debating that now is the time we must do something to get rid of Article 370. So this is an environment created not only in Kashmir but around as well, which is seen to be not conducive for the relationship between the Union and Kashmir. I am a little blunt. Please forgive me. I am one among you. But These are the hard realities. That's why I said I dare to talk about, I dare to talk openly here, that there are the hard challenges our country is facing, and we must accept, we must admit this. You see, what is the idea of India? When people of Kashmir defied the religious appeal of Pakistan and joined secular India, the appeal was that the idea of India is that we can live together. Here is a country full of diversities. Here is a country where Muslims can be there, Hindus, Christians can be there, Buddhists can be there, Malayali speaking, Tamil speaking, Kashmiri speaking, Bengal speaking, Punjab speaking. Such a beautiful country. Now you are trying to do what? You are trying one code. You are putting conditions everywhere. You are debating over such issues? Do you think that it will not create certain area of dissatisfaction, irritation among larger sections of the people? Talk to Dalits, how do they feel now? Many sections of Dalits are facing humiliations and feeling humiliated. Not that just they are not Indians, they are part of Indian stream, they are part of Indian society. But just because they are not getting that treatment which they feel is due to them. So anyway, that's why I was saying in my initial remarks that I am not concerned about the geography only, the territorial integrity. More important is the people's unity. More important is the welfare of the crores of people of our country. Thank you. Please listen to me. Now you know about Gauraksha campaigns and all that. Prime Minister spoke today. I welcome it. Good. But after, it's too late, isn't it? But still, I am hopeful. He must follow up. He must take action. Implement this, whatever he has said. There has been huge atmosphere of intolerance created around. Did he ever, my Prime Minister, that's not yours only, that's my Prime Minister as well. I expect him to speak on the floor of the House and condemn whatever is being done to vitiate the atmosphere of tolerance in India. My country, your country. Has he ever made a comment on the floor of the House? Has he condemned it? Never. I, as a citizen, am praying to Prime Minister of India to talk to the people of Kashmir through Parliament. Please, Parliament is in session. One word of concern about the emerging situation in Kashmir. Do you feel that I am doing something wrong by requesting, by appealing to my Prime Minister to say something which is required to be done for my people? I am duty bound, sir. You see, the first thing is that I expressed my opinion about this subject, thinking that many of us know the history of how it evolved. And I mentioned that it is a unique relationship. Why I mentioned this is unique? Unique is in special circumstances it emerged. Special circumstances means when there was the partition, there were certain options left to the states to join either Indian domain or Pakistani. To join either India or Pakistan. Kashmir being first bordering with Pakistan, that's first qualification. Second qualification is a Muslim majority area. Of course, our people are having a great religious appeal. You know, here even a progressive state like Kerala is influenced by such appeal. So this is true about other states. Why not Jammu and Kashmir? These are two areas where Pakistani leadership felt that it is an inalienable part of Pakistan, a natural part of, natural ally of Pakistan. And it did not happen. And there was a Maharaja, he was a Hindu Maharaja. And there was a movement against Britishers, British domination in the rest of the country, in subcontinent, Quit India movement, and there was a separate movement going on in Jammu and Kashmir called Quit Kashmir movement. They were not together in that struggle. They were sharing certain values. They were not part of the same movement. Please try to understand. These were two separate movements. Even before 47, here was a Quit India movement in the whole subcontinent, while as in Kashmir, there was a Quit Kashmir movement. Here was a movement which was essentially directed against British imperialism, while as in Kashmir, here was a movement directed essentially against the princely, that order, that Maharaja, Dogra Kal, Dogra rule, and against feudalism. Please try to understand. These were the two distinct personalities, two distinct situations. Maharaja Hari Singh, despite being Hindu, did not join India. He was reluctant. You just open up. That is why Jammu Kashmir was virtually independent for two months. It was neither part of Pakistan nor part of India. There was reluctance. And in between he was talking to Maharaja Hari Singh. He was talking to Pakistan. He offered a standstill agreement to both the countries, India as well as Pakistan, for making Jammu and Kashmir an independent entity. Please try to understand, independent is not merging with India. Had Pakistan not done otherwise, sent the raiders, things would have been different. Please try to understand it. Till then, Maharaja was in dialogue with Pakistan for some sort of a status other than acceding to either India or Pakistan. It did not materialize. Just because Pakistan was in hurry, they sent raiders to attack Kashmir. it was under those circumstances that this whole situation emerged in a different manner, and Maharaja wrote to Lord Mountbatten, the then Governor General, seeking accession with certain conditions. And read this letter, the response of the then Governor General. He said, once normalcy is restored in Jammu and Kashmir, once law and order is restored, we will refer this issue to the people. To the people means seeking their opinion whether they want to remain independent, whether they want to go to Pakistan, whether they want to go to India. That's why, please, don't be emotional about these things. These are historical facts. The emergence of Constituent Assembly took place because there was a unique situation, because even Maharaja was not willing to be part of India. My point is this. So that was that bad? You see, even now we are, our country, there's a debate going on whether we have more powers vested with the center, or we should have powers with the center in those areas where it is required, like defense of the country, foreign affairs, communication, and other areas too. And most of the powers must be transferred to the states. That's what we talk of substantially as state center relationships laid on the basis of a genuine federal structure. That's not bad for India. But there are some people who say, like the one Hindutva forces, they are arguing that federalism and all that, if you go through the literature, I'm not abusing anybody. I'm not accusing anybody. I am rather putting the facts before you. The factual position, the ideological position of certain amount of this ideology has been to have a unitary system in India, which we feel because of huge diversities, we have to be partners together, shaping the future of the country. That's called federalism. And if in Kashmir there is a separate constituent assembly, separate constitution, one more constitution, is that bad? How does it threaten the security of the country? Look towards Europe, look towards America, look towards other areas of the country, of the world. There are sufficient grounds emerging for more federal structures, and not bad. And finally, you have to deal with the people. People must be, my dear brother, willing to be part of you. If people are not willing to be part of you, mere constitutional measures cannot bind them together. The first thing is stop treating the people, own the sufferings of the people, own the people of Kashmir that they are part of you. Treat them like human beings. That is the first confidence healing measure. Unfortunately, one average Kashmiri is asking me, Tarigami, if this happens in any other part of the country, what will be the attitude? They are citing the recent example of Haryana, where huge property was burned. Huge! In Arabs. So much of devastation has taken place. Jat agitation. They are asking the question, how many people got killed there? How unfortunate. Should we count the bodies now? They are asking why we are not being treated at par, if not more, at par. Suppose it happens here, anywhere, whether you are in army or outside. Finally, army means what? Police means what? We are part of the same society. We are together. A police person or police officer is here. I respect him. He is protecting me. I am grateful. As a citizen, I seek his protection. Similarly, a Kashmiri here on the streets, he may be angry, he may be demonstrating, he may be agitating, and he has to help him. He has to provide some sort of a relief to him. So that is why the first thing Kashmiri, average Kashmiri is wanting us to do is treat us like others. Treat us as human beings. That is important. Stop use of excessive force. We talk of excessive force. Wherever force is required, you do it. You have to stop infiltration at the borders, please do that. You have to deal with certain amount of subversives, please do that. But please don't deal with the whole community of Kashmiris as terrorists. Don't deal them like that. As my friend has said, he has visited recently and found them quite normal, decent. How is it that they are becoming violent? Why? There can be a reason. That reason is that they are not being treated well. That's why I suggest the second point is put a stop for excessive use of force. Third thing is there is some ailment, a serious ailment, where in areas of political approach, please talk to them. I'm not asking you give them, you not to give them. What I am suggesting, what CPIM is suggesting is please talk to them. To whom? Who are with you and who are not with you. Both. Your own population. And find out they agreed some common ground to move forward. If there is any, that is the strength of our democracy. We have to listen to and we have to exchange our views, we have to exchange our concerns, and we have to accommodate them as well for living together. This is to be done everywhere. This has to be done same way in Kashmir as well. But you are elected. You are not doing anything. You have promised. Now take for example, I will tell you, 2010, a parliamentary delegation visited, they have made certain recommendations. Please implement those recommendations. You have, as Prime Minister of India, Manmohan Singh Ji, constituted working groups. My friend might be knowing, or you can just go visit the website of Kashmir. And you will find that working groups made recommendations. Those working groups, one of the working groups was headed by our Vice President, today's Vice President. Another was Mr. Foreign Affairs Secretary, a renowned personality, Mr. S. Gotra. There are very, very important functionaries of civil services, of different areas who were heading those working groups, seeing the areas which have remained neglected to be attended to, made recommendations. Please examine those recommendations and implement them. And you have thrice posted or constituted three groups of interlocutors. One, Mr. K.C. Pant. He was Vice Chairman of the Planning Commission. Another, Anand Vora, who continues to be, first he was the Defense Secretary, now he is our Governor in Jammu and Kashmir. He was interlocutor. And another in 2010, you have constituted team of interlocutors headed by one senior journalist, Padgaonkar. They made recommendation. You have not placed those recommendations even on the floor of the parliament. Not informing the countrymen what they have said, what they have not said, my dear brother. You have constituted. It's not that somebody else has constituted. And they are our own people. There are high-placed personalities. Please open up and place it in the parliament and suggest measures which you can accept, which you cannot. Please inform the country. Final thing is, in 96 elections, in a difficult situation, army fought all of us together, and finally elections took place. 96. In a very difficult situation, and when Narasimha Rao Ji, 1 year before, had said, sky is the limit about autonomy. When Farooq Abdullah was told to fight elections and all others, he was told that you just get the mandate of the people and we will consider autonomy question. I was part of the assembly. We adopted a resolution for granting more autonomy to the state. Please ask them, because you are journalists, please ask this government, what happened to that resolution of the assembly? That assembly was not passed by militants, not by separatists, but by duly constituted assembly of Jammu and Kashmir. That was not even acknowledged. And it was NDA government then again. They did not form even a committee to discuss it with us. What to do, what not to do, what is to be acceptable, what is not to be acceptable. They did not inform us even the reasons for its rejection. Don't you feel it is humiliation? To what? To the mandate of the people? I am talking to you, my dear friend, these are the mandates. Now again you talk about Sheikh Abdullah was mandated by the people, you are imprisoning him without taking him into confidence or without taking the people in general into confidence. Anyway, this is the series of blunders committed. I am not abusing anybody, I am abusing only one thing, that is we are not taking care of the overall national interest. It's not good for the country. So anyway, sir, these are important issues. And finally, I am grateful that you have provided me this opportunity to listen to you, to talk to you. And this is, my dear, very dear friend, again, the tragedy of Kashmiri Pandits. I just want to inform, I am the first one who was forced to migrate, because I was targeted in 89, before openly the militancy started in 89, and I was forced. I was the first person who left home and was in Jammu for some time, then again back to Srinagar, under protection, of course. That is a tragedy. Their leaving is tragedy. Whatever is happening today, it's a tragedy. This is different phases, different facets of the same tragedy. I feel pain, and I am a believer. Kashmiri soul cannot be at rest unless that day comes when our brethren who were forced to migrate return back with dignity and with security. That's my dream. Thank you very much.